Accept our thanks in Jesus.
Amen.
My Lord and my Savior, I'm praying that all those who are rejoicing with your son today, their own joy also will last forever.
Amen.
Even in the few words that our people will be hearing today, that healing power that comes with your word, let it go out to them in Jesus'
name.
At the end of everything, take all the glory.
Amen.
In Jesus' mighty name we have prayed.
Amen.
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 When he was 60 years old, I was there. When he was 70 years old, I was there. Now he's 80. I am here.
Amen.
So you must be wondering, what's so special about this kid? Well, there are so many things. As I probably have told you before, we met where we went to Suka in the 1960s. That's a long time ago. Before some of the people here were born. And even then, even though those of us from the West, quite a few of us were very rascally in those days. But he was different. Even at that time, at that age, you could see quality in him. So those of us who were very rascally, we still gave him his due. And we've been together since then, and I thank God that we're still together today.
Amen.
So if you don't see me at your own birthday, you need to understand. Glory be to God.
Hallelujah.
With long life will I satisfy him and show him my salvation. Let's start from verse 1. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High. That tells you there's someone called the Most High. And we're talking about levels in life. We know that there are grades and there are grades. In the educational section, we have assistant lecturer, we have lecturer grade 1, lecturer grade 2, lecturer grade 1, senior lecturer, professor, and then head of department, and dean, and VC. Everything in grades. In the legal sector, you have the magistrate court, you have the high court, you have the appeal court, you have the supreme court, and the other. But there is someone higher than everybody else, and it's called the Most High. It's higher than everybody else because according to Isaiah 66 verse 1, he said, heaven is my throne. The earth is my footstool. So it doesn't matter how high your whole throne is, it's still under his feet. Your entire earth, he uses as a footstool. Ecclesiastes chapter 5 verse 8, Ecclesiastes 5 verse 8 says, he is higher than the highest. You look at somebody and the fellow thinks he is higher than everybody else, there's someone higher than that fellow still. Incidentally, that person is called Jesus. Philippians chapter 2 verse 9, says, God has given him a name that's above every name. Four boys were playing, and you know when boys play. You listen to them, they are most likely bragging about their father. He said, my father is higher than all your fathers. And they said, how come? He said, because my father is the head of state, so he's the number one man in the country. Oh, the second boy said, my father is higher than your father. He said, how can that be? He said, because my father is your father's physician. Is your father's herbalist. They can kill your fathers. And the fourth one said that my father is higher than all your fathers. And he happens to be the son of the messenger in the state house. Ah, come. We know your father. I said, oh, no, you don't know my father. Because my father, not only can he kill, he can make a life. We know your father, and I said, no, you are talking of the messenger. I'm talking of my father in heaven. His name is Jesus. He's the one who is higher than the highest. I'm praying that the one who is higher than the highest will promote you today. Now this Most High, according to Psalm 91 verse 1, has a secret place. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the special prosperity. But as soon as you are satisfied, I think it should be the time to go. I think some days ago when we were talking, you said that some of us are already in the departure lounge. Some of us have already got boarding pass. We're just waiting for the Lord to say, hey, it is time to go.
You see, the reason people are afraid to die
And you have lived a fruitful life. You have children, you have grandchildren, you have done everything anybody could do. What are you doing here again? The moment your grandchildren begin to say to you, Daddy, when are you going? You know you are already overstayed. The reason people are afraid to die is because they don't know where they are going. Because they know they are going to die. And they don't know what is on the other side. And they know there is something on the other side. Life does not end here. Death is a new beginning. Even our forefathers who never read the Bible, they knew it. You hear them say, whatever you have done will be waiting for you at the gate. Which gate are they talking about? The gate of heaven. But those of us who are children of the Most High God, we know what is waiting. It is glory ahead, not shame ahead. If God will open your eyes and let you see what is waiting for you in heaven, you will not want to stay here longer than necessary. As a matter of fact, I've told my children, because by God's grace, I've seen my own house over there. If you see your house in heaven, the only reason you won't kill yourself is that those who commit suicide won't get there. That's the only reason. That's the only reason. Because, I mean, I tried to explain heaven to my children not too long ago. I said the first time I went to America, way back in 1970-something, it was in summer. I've never seen anything so beautiful. The sun was still shining by 9:30 p.m. And at that time, I went to a city that they said was the number three cleanest city in America. You can drop your food on the ground and pick it up and eat. I saw the vehicle washing the street. Light didn't blink once. Water flowed freely. And I was living in Moshe. When I was returning, and we got to Lithuania, and they said, fasten your seatbelt. And I looked down and I saw Moshe, and I said, oh God. Back to prison. And that's a very poor illustration of heaven versus earth. That place is beautiful. The very ground is not just ordinary gold. It's the kind of gold that is transparent. The walls of the mansion, you can see through. You see what is going on inside. And when we're talking about beauty, we're talking about beauty. Man came to me and said, sir, I hear you're a prophet of God. I said, me? Not a prophet, I'm a pastor. He said that they said that whatever you say come to pass. I said, I hear from God once in a while, and God has been faithful. He said, very good. And you tell me my future. I said, that's no problem. You answer a simple question, and I tell you your future. He said, what's the question? Are you born again? He said, no. I said, your future will be terrible. How do you know? You have not even prayed. You have not even asked my name. There is no need to pray. It is written. Isaiah chapter 3 verse 11. Woe to the wicked. He shall be ill with him. God said it. There's this parable of three fishes. I call them fishes because they are various species. In case you want to correct my English. And these three little fishes were swimming in the ocean, but they were being tormented by a shark and a baby shark. So one day, the three fishes had a prayer meeting. So you know, the peculiar fishes. And I said, Lord, you must come down. We want to talk to you. So the Lord came down and said, yes, what can I do for you?
The first priest said, because of these sharks here, I want to have eyes all over my body. The Lord said, why? Oh, so that long before these sharks can come near me, I will see them. And then I'll be able to escape. Well, if that's what you want, you can have it. And immediately, all the scales of the body of the fish became eyes. Very beautiful. The second one said, I want a pair of wings. So that when these sharks are coming, I just fly out of the river. And then they can fly, so I be safe. Well, if that's what you want, you can have it. So we develop two powerful wings. And the Lord turned to the third one and said, and what do you want? The third one said, all I want is that wherever you go with me. Okay, that's what you want. And so the Lord left. And so the shark and the baby shark were hunting. And the first fish they saw was a fish with many eyes. Ah, this is a beautiful fish. So they began to pursue. And the fish swam, God saw them coming, swam towards the beach. And because it had so many eyes, he saw a little pool of water on the beach. Made a big effort and landed in that pool of water. And began to laugh at the shark and say, hey, come and get me here. But very soon, the sun rose. And the little pool of water on the beach dried up. And the fish with many eyes died. Now when the shark found that he missed the first fish, they turned and they saw the fish with wings. Oh, well, here's another one. Let's go for this. And that one just flew out of the ocean. And said, I've got a solution to you now. You can fly. Come and get me here. So, the fish began to fly. But around that time, an eagle was flying overhead. I said, oh Lord, I don't know you can be this good. And I've always wanted to eat fish, only I can't swim. And then he brought one to me in my room. And so the fish ended up in the stomach of the eagle. And then the baby shark said to the mother shark, there's a third one here. This one doesn't seem to be afraid of us. Let's go and get him. And the mother shark said, are you blind? Can't you see that wherever this fish is going, there's a shark of a man following it? You go near that fish, the man whose shadow you see will take care of you. The Lord is your shade. From your right hand. When you belong to him, there is a shadow you might not be able to see, but your enemies can see. And that will keep you forever secure.